And at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time. And then they're on their merry way.
Hello again, everyone. I'm Erik Sprowls, and I was the director of In Neon.
And I'm Jessica Vatter, and I played Laura Phillips.
And for the next hour, we're going to take you kind of on a behind-the-scenes retrospective commentary on the third episode of the series. There's not really any titles to these episodes.
No, I don't know. I don't know, it's just episode 3 of In Neon.
So I tell you what, let's just delve right into it, and we'll tell you some of the thoughts and what went on behind the scenes in making the third episode. This opening, actually, I don't even know if you know this or not, was an accident. I wasn't going to do an opening for any episode.
I did not know
we
that.
We were just going to fade right up and start it, and then somebody said it'd be a really good idea if you did a usual opening. And that musical montage was actually in the first episode of the, I guess I call it the movie.
Yeah.
It didn't really
and it
happen.
Was much longer beginning, different music.
Right, and it didn't really have a beginning to it. When we delve into the open here, a lot of people ask me as a director, do you do anything in every episode that has something to do, like Hitchcock would always have cameos, Spielberg would always put a shooting star. So in everything I've done, and if you look somewhere in every episode of In Neon or any other production I've done something with the Steelers. Because I love the Pittsburgh Steelers. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
You didn't know that I like the Steelers?
It's only like everywhere.
It's good to put it in a video game. And
son of a bitch!
My dad actually enjoyed the fact that Brett's car used to be owned by Yancey Thigpen, of all people. My dad thought that was hilarious.
Really?
Yeah.
I know. That's, I made that up off the top. Right on the sheet, too.
I was like, Yancey Thigpen?
It'd be really cool if... well, Brett's supposed to have a lot of money.
Yes.
And, I mean, he... And it's reflected in later episodes. You'll see... I don't even think you know some of the stuff that he does in later episodes. But he bought the car off Yancey Thigpen's side. It was just like a junk car that Yancey drove around. He bought it and said... Since he was supposed to be such a big fan of the Steelers, he took the car.
Now, was Jared really playing this game? Because I find it hard to believe that he would have been that decent at playing football game.
No, Jared knows nothing about video games.
He's not. He does, actually. He likes that Max Payne for the Xbox.
But, oh, really?
Yeah, but that's like the first time I've ever seen him play anything. I can't see him playing a football game.
He knows nothing about football. It's amazing, too, because he's supposed to be the biggest fan of this, too.
And Dante, he actually is the one who knows all about football, so
mm-hmm.
It's kind of unusual.
Now, this particular scene I thought was kind of nice because it set up the initial relationship that Brett has with Jen. And Mark tells him that he's going to the football game and he's going to... see Jen perform. She has a solo. And Brett says, I don't want any part of that because, you know, I don't like band geeks. And of course, I have to close on the Steelers. Best tight end in football. Now, this scene kind of opened a lot of eyes. It wasn't really controversial, but it's the first time you get to see Jen directing. You see, Jen's been in the episodes now for 2 episodes. This is the 3rd episode. You don't really know a lot about her. And this is where Brett kind of spies on her a little bit to see, he hears some music playing. And this is the first time you see her directing. And you see that she's like a, not really a band geek, but she's really into the marching band and she wants to make something of herself.
We had to teach her how to do that, too, us being former real-life band geeks. She's like, how do you... She's waving her arms all around. We're like, it's down, in, out, up. So she caught on pretty good.
Yeah, it was kind of funny. She didn't know anything about conducting. So we spent a lot of time with her teaching her how to be a drum major for most of this episode.
Oh,
I'm sorry, I was...
And it's kind of nice, too, because they meet a little bit not by accident here, but by surprise. I always like those kind of initial meetings. This is the real first time that Brett and Jen have a chance to discuss or talk about anything. And, I mean, they've seen each other throughout the first couple shows, but this is the first time they get to really sit down and talk about each other and each other's interests.
Stands there and directs the band in the white uniform.
This particular scene here was a blooper, but it's a reaction shot to her talking, so I kept it because it was just funny. I thought it was funny.
Yeah, like him nosing through all of her stuff and
that
messing it all
mistake.
Up. And
he actually knocked it over.
In case you haven't noticed, my cousin thinks I'm kind of shy, so I'm trying to get over it.
And the sure way of getting over it is standing out there in the limelight for everyone to see.
Well, I've had fun with the band since
I thought the Mr. Holland's Opus poster was a nice touch. Because it defines her as a music major. And he kind of gave it a double take, like, what kind of...
Nerd alert.
Yeah.
I'm out of the room. What I like to watch. Just the Steelers.
It's funny watching this now because a lot of the lighting is hidden. And obviously it takes place at night, but, you know, there's, you know, in retrospect, there's lighting. You can't even see them in reflection of the glass back there, but there's, like, people everywhere. I think you were even here this night.
I was here this night, yeah.
Eating pizza.
Hanging out.
Yeah, this scene didn't involve you, but at least you were there, showing your moral support.
Yeah, that's important. I'm good at that.
So Brett discovers that Jen is engaged, and I think in a way, he finds that as a challenge.
Pre-engaged.
Oh, that's right, pre-engaged. I think he finds that as a challenge. But I think on different levels, Brett also wants to, he just met her, you know, he just wants to help her. I don't think he's really interested this time. Now the look is important. We keep bringing that up. Throughout the entire series.
But it's mostly just between, like, it's like a him thing. Like, him and her, it's their characters that talk about the look and always want the look.
Right.
Nobody else really does it.
Exactly, and they mention it a couple times because it sets up later in the series when Jen gives Brett the look. And I got the idea, well, really from personal experience, you know.
Yeah.
You've gone out and it's like if someone's walking away, if they turn and they stop and they look back at you, they're interested.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And I always thought about that. And then I saw it in a Clint Eastwood movie, in The Line of Fire, when he's sitting on the steps of, I think it's Congress, the House of Representatives, or something in Washington, D.C., and Renee Russo's walking away. And the whole time that she's walking away, he's like, come on, give me the look, give me the look. And she turns around and looks at him. Then he smiles. He's sitting there on the steps eating ice cream. Clint Eastwood, you know, Mr. Tough Guy.
That is how you know when it's for real.
Well, it's certainly better than the Jell-O story.
You know, I think it's a little...
This is also the first time that Tom is brought up, Jen's boyfriend, her fiancé. We kind of learn that he's kind of like a pocket-protecting...
Listen, I got some time right now.
Very...
He's a straight-out geek.
Yeah.
He's a nerd.
And...
Total.
And he's kind of turned Jen into one. And not the fact that she's in the band, because I think that band thing is a strong... hint of her character and what she wants to do with her life, because her life is music. But he's trying to pull her out a little bit here, I think. By
she's become, like, ultra-conservative. She's, like, a vegetarian, and not that there's anything wrong with being a vegetarian, but, like, everything is real sheltered, and she doesn't really like to get spontaneous or crazy, and... That's how Brett is, so...
Which is another key to her character, too, because it's revealed in later episodes that she used to be a stripper. And that's all over with now. She's all sheltered now, and, like, everything's changed. And she's lost her outgoing side. And that's what Brett helps her find. This was all shot at Adamson Stadium at California University of Pennsylvania on a football day. And because Adamson Stadium doesn't really draw huge football crowds, it was done in a lot of quick edits. So you got the feeling of game day. And
tons of people.
Tons of people, and probably there's 300 people in the stands.
Yeah.
And of course, Brett told Mark that he wasn't going to go see the band perform because that's for wackos and geeks and I have no part in that. But after he had the conversation with Jen, I think he's kind of interested now. And he goes to see Jen perform. This is actual footage of the university marching band, and I think if you look close, somewhere down on the xylophone.
It's me. It's you. It's like from 2 years ago.
Because you're a real member of the marching
there
band.
There I am, right there.
It's funny because any time that we did a lot of concert footage, I never realized this until I go back and look at these episodes, you're in this a lot. Like, if you watch the soap for a while, you're going to have to look hard to spot you, but I've spotted you in three times, not in this particular scene, but throughout the series, you're in the marching band. One of the times is in the fifth episode during the Christmas concert that you're attending with Dante, with Mark.
There's no one else on the field with her right there. That is...
There's no way to get around that.
I know, but that's just, it's cool how like we tried to make it like, she's there, she's in the band.
It's kind of a nice...
Very quick back and forth close up. You can't even really... To somebody who doesn't know, you can't really tell.
It's a special effect. It's trick photography because we give her the impression of being in the band when we shot her close-ups, there was no one there at all. We just intercut her with this kind of footage. And that's one of the secrets that we had to get by with when you had no budget. You know, the band wouldn't go up and give a performance for us because we wanted to make a movie.
Yeah.
So we had to use stock footage that CUTV does at halftime of football games and integrate that with close-ups of her directing or whatever. And there's the trick photography that all of a sudden she's in there and on the field performing. That's the first time you see her in the band. I think it might be the only, well, I can't say the only time. The marching band.
In the marching band, that's the only appearance the Calu marching band makes.
Oh, and here the infamous continuity continues. When he leaves, notice what he's wearing. A blue shirt, white highlights, short sandals. Because when he's at the office, when he goes to the radio show to do his show, Cleve, Grant, can't remember his continuity ever.
I still insist that Cleve stopped somewhere along the way and changed in his car.
Yeah, and he's doing
the
like
viewing audience will believe that.
When he changed in his car, he put a sweater on and jeans. It's interesting too in that prior scene there when Mary Cindy walked by, she was missing a tooth that day. She lost a tooth playing rugby because
yes.
She's a professional rugby player.
And
she covers it up with Tic Tacs.
She had chewing gum. She chewed it up and like stuck it in there with her tongue, and it was amazing. It looked totally fine on camera.
Yeah, you couldn't even tell it was missing. I like this scene between the three of them because since we're early in the series, I always saw these three as the three musketeers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Jack, Mark, and Brett. And of course, he would be Porthos because he likes to get into the fights. And that's what this scene's all about, is gelling. It's like a male bonding scene. You know how whenever women get together, I don't know what you women talk about.
Oh, you don't want to know what we talk about.
But this is kind of like a male bonding scene.
And 35 to 40. What about the ones in their 20s?
It doesn't matter.
You want to field this one, Mark?
No, you go ahead.
Why, Brett?
Well, you see...
Anytime you see us drinking on campus, even in the house, there is... Nothing in the bottles. Maybe water if we've cleaned the bottles out thoroughly enough, but like it's part of keeping from getting in trouble. Like we always have empty bottles. And you have to fake drinking and try to make it look like you're actually drinking something, which is harder than it looks.
It was an interesting line there that Brett commented on. It says 18 to 21 because they're naive and 35 to 40 because they're desperate. Comes from a friend of mine that you know who plays the band director later on in the series, X. They call him X. He's named after a letter. His real name's Xavier Maxwell. He's a disc jockey who was a student here at the university for a while, and he came up with that theory, and I laughed so hard when I heard that because it was such a male pig egotistical thing, you know?
No, I did not sleep with Professor Wallace.
This is a great story.
I slept with his wife.
And I like it too. It's just a great male bonding scene. They're just hanging out, drinking beers on a wall at school.
I told you. I mean, that's awful. What was I supposed to do in that situation?
I don't know.
I can't even imagine being in that situation.
So Mark slept with his advisor's wife.
It's funny because this night, Brett and Mark, Dante and Jared, got into an argument. This scene took 3 or 4 nights to shoot in front of the president's house. At the
I was here for this night, too, for part of it. I think I stopped after work.
Dante, Mark there, he had had enough. He's cranky and tired. He wants to go home. And so we had to shoot all his close-ups, and then he left. So a lot of the times that these two these three are having conversations, Mark's not even... So you don't even see Mark there. He was long gone by this time. You know, and some of these edits, it's craftily put together that he's not even there on those nights. You see, you don't see him there either. So most of his close-ups were shot ahead of time. And he's not even around.
And that...
right here, Jared kept falling down off the side of that wall. For some reason, his foot kept getting caught, and it was hilarious.
No, we didn't.
Now, the gentleman over there at the fountain, his name is Damon Taylor, a good friend of Jared's and mine. He was a basketball star at California University. And we wanted to create, after you saw a male bonding scene where they're talking, having some good laughs, we wanted to create the usual Three Musketeers, let's fight for fun. And it was good because later on in the series there are several fights, and after you watch this one where they fight for fun, you kind of learn later on when they fight without the other one, it's much more serious. There's much more danger. So this is more of like a lighthearted romp that you're about to see.
I think this is also another reflection of how Brett's character is sort of macho and a little sexist, because you always hear, like, about the guys who come into the bar and when they get drunk, they always fight. They always were looking for a fight or finding somebody to fight, and it's always thought of as being, you know, sort of Neanderthalish and very male. But so I think that kind of... Because these two aren't really into it all that much. It's always Brett that starts it. So.
And it's nice, too, because you see Jack pulling his hat down. Who could ever imagine Dante in a fight? Mark, because he's blind. And these two guys over there at the fountain, it looks like it's going to be 3-on-2 here. It looks like it was going to be 3-on-1 at the beginning. And Vince, he plays a good tough
guy. Why not? Why not, dude?
Because tomorrow there'll be a rainbow back there. And we shouldn't have to deal with it.
Because tomorrow there'll be a rainbow back there, and... What was the rest?
And we shouldn't have to deal with it.
And we shouldn't have to deal with it!
I love that reaction shot. I wish it could have lasted a lot longer.
Everyone who I've ever watched this with after that, they, like, before Brett has the reaction, they're like, what does that mean? And I was like, just wait. And then he's like, doesn't make any sense.
You too. Yeah, why is that? Because.
I like it. Brett goes out on a limb.
Ugly chick of a girlfriend. I mean a real good look. Oh, no.
I liked it because Jack was feeding Brett all the lines to say that wouldn't cause anything, and then Brett went out on a line by his own.
That did it.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Okay, Mark, you know the routine. Routine? What routine?
And Mark, of course, he doesn't really want to fight. I mean, who would want to?
No.
It's like fighting with your eyes closed, you know? But I thought a nice tie-in here was, you know, we don't want to show that Mark has zero guts, and he's actually the one in the end who instigates
everything. Back me up. Fine. I'll deal with it myself.
Fine.
Good. Fine.
It's like Jack is the brains, and Jared's the brawn, Brett's the brawn, and then Mark is the unexpected surprise.
That's one thing.
Come on over here, jerk off.
Got it. Now, it's funny, this particular fight was shot, I guess it was about 40 or 50 degrees. And as the fight wore on, over the period of a couple of nights, it got to be like 80 or 90 degrees, and Jared's like, ugh, can I take this sweatshirt off? I'm like, you chose to have it on. So fortunately, when we shot the cutaway shots where Stacy pulls in the car and he goes over, he says, oh, can I be really chivalrous and gallant and give you my sweatshirt? Because you're out here all cold and they left you. And he's like, yeah, sure. So that's how he ends up getting rid of his sweatshirt. Because it's so hot. It's like we're shooting in 90 degrees, but we had shot prior when it was colder and he had a sweatshirt on.
Jack, I'm not fighting.
There's no way I'm fighting. Screw him. You know what? Every time he gets involved with something like this, I'm the one that always gets my ass kicked.
What'd you say about my girlfriend?
A lot of times on this particular night, too, or on these nights, the forecast was thunderstorms, and we had to dodge the rain. Like, we'd shoot this close-up, for instance, the rain would start, and we'd all jump on the president's porch, you know, tear down the lights. And one time, I had to take my hat off to Dr. Armetti, who's the university president. He came out and gave us cookies. It was the coolest thing, you know?
I'm doing fine.
You're here with these guys.
Stacey, I love that girl. She does my hair. She did my hair for the award show. She gave me my initial haircut for the first episode. I had real long hair all one length. I was like, I need something that makes me look sexy.
You know,
so
originally,
she hooked me up.
Stacey auditioned for your role. And it really came down between the two of them. But I had other plans in mind for her. That's how we lost the sweatshirt. Now it's like 100 degrees. And then when we shot the fight scene after he got rid of the shirt and said, ah, now I can be nice and cool. It got cold again. And he couldn't put it back on because he already lost it. I said, I don't know what to tell you, dude.
It was the thrills of shooting during an Indian summer. Like one day it was 80 degrees and the next day it was like 50.
You know, in some of the takes, when he goes over here to start the fight, Brett, whenever we'd yell cut, he'd put a coat on, you know, and... Now, the character of Mark, I really like a lot, and it's funny because he wasn't developed to be a blind character until the third or fourth revision in the script. And he's kind of, you can see he's having the conversation with the wrong way, and he's looking real pathetic, and I remember a lot of people said, oh, come on, he can sense when people's in the room. He can sense when this kind of stuff happens here and there. I said, he's looking the wrong way. And I said, it's all part of his charm because he's not really being blind. He's setting these guys up. He goes through this routine each and every week. And it's kind of nice to see. I didn't want a pathetic blind character. I wanted a powerful blind character. And Dante pulled that off pretty well. He kind of zeroes in on everybody in the group. With the one sense that it has become more acute since he's lost his sight. And he does something completely unexpected.
And Brett stands there smiling because he knows this whole time what's coming up.
Right. This is a routine that they've worked out between the three of them time and time again. And like I said, it's a great male bonding scene.
Robert De Niro was not in Scent of a Woman. It was Al Pacino.
And no one expected that.
No one see this movie?
And I like the music we used here, too. It's kind of an Irish concerto. Very light, very, you know, the good old boys are having a fight at the hoedown. You know?
Yeah.
And this was some music that my grandmother owned, actually, because she was Irish to the core. And the fight scene is not... I think it's nicely choreographed with what we had to work with. We had to shoot it in one night from multiple angles. So we had to readjust lighting, and it was a huge nut. Now, that was nice, because I like to watch those kind of fights, kind of like Raiders of the Lost Ark fights. You know, where somebody will throw a punch at the wrong guy, and it doesn't exactly work out the way it's supposed to, when Dante hit the wrong guy.
It's the idea of a night out.
Who's your daddy?
I love that right there when Damon asks him, who's your daddy? I was like, oh, that's great. It's great improv.
So, the Hollywood Grill is a bar in the town of California, PA, that we learned throughout the series is kind of like the hangout for some of our characters. And most of these people you see walking around, mulling around here, are actors or extras in some way, shape, or form. From the bartender to just people walking around.
No, Mark, you wouldn't have to fight the big ones if you wouldn't pick the big ones to fight with in the first place.
How the hell was I supposed to do?
Which was amazing in itself because a lot of the people are unpaid. No one's paid in this. And we had to base it all on volunteer work.
Now, this is at Halloween, so I made this little, like, pseudo-Halloween costume because I thought Laura would be fun and she would do something like this, and no one got what it was. They were like, are you a are you a mouse? Are you a rabbit? I'm like, I'm a cat. I'm a white kitty cat. So we like worked that into the script. So here they say, I think she's a bunny. I think she's a mouse.
It was also a joke on the set. Everybody kept calling you Miss Mouse. And I knew that had to be getting on your nerves after a while, you know?
I was like, this is the last time I try to do something for the sake of, you know, the holiday. Because we didn't shoot this at Halloween, so, like, there was really nothing, no kind of decorations at the bar, and I just thought it would be cool to emphasize what season it was.
And I like this scene here, too, because LeVar, the gentleman sitting at the table, was one of our writers on the show. And we kind of give him a cameo.
Yeah.
Sorry, I lost your chance.
This actually was one of my favorite scenes in the whole soap opera so far between you and Mark. It's where, you know, in the story, you have two friends that, without on purpose trying, because you guys are friends in this, without trying at all, you accidentally start crossing the line. You know what I mean? And those are the best kind of love stories, you know? It's where you two are starting to bond and get together and talk, and you've been friends for years, and it just kind of by accident sort of starts to evolve into something else.
I started, I remember this night, I started getting sick, and by the next night, like in the next 24 hours, I was like deathly ill, and Dante especially enjoyed picking on me and tried telling me that I had anthrax. And ever, the camera would be like, cut, and I'd be like, oh, and he'd be like, you have anthrax. I was like, stop saying that, it's not funny.
This wasn't shot too long after 9-1-1, too. It was like a day or two afterwards. Well, maybe.
Yeah, it was a little while, because we had the, it was the big anthrax scare. Everybody was...
If you look here in the background, we have the way it's shot, there are a lot of people talking to other people and that kind of thing off camera. And for instance, they'll show close-ups of Mark, and you'll see over his shoulder LeVar, one of our writers, in the background talking in the background, not in this particular shot, but he's actually talking to no one, just to someone off screen. The way it was shot though is kind of tricky.
And she's coming over.
Oh, you're kidding. Look at crap.
This is hilarious because Dante and I have this, like, on-screen, you know, chemistry romance. And then as soon as the camera, as soon as it's, like, cut and the camera's off, like, he used to joke around with me all the time. Like, we would bicker constantly. He'd be like, oh, God. He'd like, you're this, like, the sister I never had. And I was like, oh, you're the brother I never wanted. So it was just funny. We'd go from, like, bickering, and then as soon as... they'd say action, we'd have to act like we wanted each other desperately, and it was funny a lot of the time.
You have good eyes, Jess. You know,
thank you.
You look at her and you're like, hi, and you're giving that look like, I guess you got to come over because it's Mark. I really don't want you to intervene, but I'm going to get out of here.
Yeah.
And you're really, at this point, I think, still looking out for him as a friend. That was a great shot of him. Every time we told Mark or Dante to act, we'd say, I want you to think Boy in the Bubble, Boy in the Bubble. And he's like, oh, yeah.
And he'd make this day's like Stevie Wonder head bob, like, Ebony and Ivory.
Well, you know, Dante in real life is not blind. In fact, he's acting is not even his major. He's one of the sports announcers at the television station we worked for. And he thought he'd give it a shot and see what would happen. And... right here, for the first time, you realize, you know, he's joked about it, you know, his disability with his sight. And, of course, we joked about it in the fight, we joked about it here and there, but this is the first time that you see it's for real. And the whole story, he's, like, telling the story, but the story's told really through your face, your expressions, your eyes. And he finally tells this girl that thought he was very cute, that I'm blind, I can't see, and she's like totally turned off and says, I'm out of here. And the story's told through you. You know, you're thinking, what a bitch. You know, and he's destroyed because nothing ever seems to go right for him when it comes to that. That's been his self-defense mechanism, I think, throughout the whole series, is the fact that he'll laugh at the fact that he's blind or make jokes about it. And it wasn't until this scene that really talked about the severity of the disability.
Mark.
Hey. What's up?
What's going on?
Oh, Amanda? Oh, nothing. She just thought...
He did that little head hang thing there where he sunk his head down. It was just... It was so sad, and he did a real good job at looking like he was just, you know, completely crushed that this was something that was totally beyond his control, and that he's probably had to deal with like 100 times.
In fact, Amy Namachar, the girl who played Amanda, who came over to the table, asked me how to perform that. And I said, think Cordelia on Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And I don't know if you know who I'm talking about or not, but very mall queen, like, ugh, I can't believe that. I hit on a blind guy, like, you know, ugh, I'm so, don't look at me. And they go over and they make jokes about it. But everybody wanted your character to go over and punch her out.
Oh, I know. Everyone thought this was going to be, like, the girls, like, we had the guy fight, and now they wanted the girl fight, and I was like, no, no. Laura's not, at this point in the series, she's not into that yet. She prefers her revenge kind of cold and with a little more class than just a knockdown, drag-out fight, so.
And that's not really the kind of thing for your character to do. Your character is probably the smartest that lives in the house out of the eight. And I think, actually, in Neon, the female characters are much more stronger than the male characters. And I love what you did here, and you stiffed them with the bill. Plus, you walked out with a case of beer. I just think that's a much better scene than having...
A knockdown, drag-out, like, cat fight, yeah.
Not paying for that whole entire cab.
No. You offered to buy them their drinks. Plurals. Now, honey, you're going to pay that.
So you stiff them with the bill, you walk out with the beer...
And that's a fight is just sort of like a macho, you know, just ignorant thing to do. Whereas stiffing them with the bill was a little more classy. It was an opportunity for Laura to really be a bitch. You know, like she gave him that look, like, yeah, thanks.
Right, and a lot
screw
of
you.
Yeah, the scene's not about the revenge. It's about Mark.
Yeah.
And if you got into some kind of a fight, there wouldn't be any kind of eventual evolution into your relationship between Laura and Mark. You know, you just went to bat for your future boyfriend.
We shot the inside and the outside on two separate nights, and I had left my coat at home that weekend, so I borrowed this coat off of a friend of mine who is a guy. We have almost the exact same coat. And I'd, like, take his home after class sometimes because we just get them mixed up. And I called him. I was like, I forgot my coat at home and I have a scene to shoot. Can I borrow yours? So his is a little bit longer than mine. But my own mother didn't even notice when she saw this, so.
Mm-hmm. And that's some of the hidden secrets.
Yeah, and it's, like, the first time. Like, I'm very good with my continuity. And this was, like, the first time I messed up real bad. And so I needed to fix it.
I think that was a cute little scene. And it was a nice... scene between the two of you. Now, here's my point. Take a look at what Cleve's wearing now. He's got his green sweater on, khaki pants.
But I always said it's not that big of a deal because so much has happened in between the house and here that people forget what he was wearing at the house and forget that this is where he was going. So it can be believed that he went back and changed or something because just so much has happened in between it.
This particular scene was shot in reality at the university radio station, WVCS, and that's one of the things that I think In Neon has above a lot of the other college soap operas that are out there. I've seen a couple in the past few years. I've even seen one on a network called the Burly Bear Network currently. You know, they'll build their sets all fake, and you know, they'll slam doors and stuff, and then the walls will shake. You know,
yeah.
We shot all of ours on location, and the university, fortunately, provided everything that we could ever want. You know, for instance, a radio station. If you want an infirmary or a hospital, you go to the campus health center. If you want a police station, you can go to public safety, you know, the campus security. And so, as Cleve is supposed to be a communication major, we shot this at the radio station.
I just like to do it.
The voice of this caller sounds very familiar.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
That is so you, Erik.
Well, it's kind of like that. It was just convenient that, yes, that is a cameo of me. I have a cameo somewhere in the soap. I don't even know if you know where it's at. I play a character later on.
Oh, I know where it's at.
But this was kind of my first cameo. I play the caller, calling in about sex advice.
To Dr. Stiles, who's played by... the wonderful Miss Jen Segato, who's in charge of the orientation and public relations type stuff on campus. She's a really cool lady. She's so fun. Mm-hmm. And she was like really willing to do this, which we thought was awesome.
And I liked her character having to do it. I know Jen so well that I wanted to put her in kind of a funny, complicated scene where, you know, she has to be a sex therapist. And then she kind of rolled her eyes and said, "How am I supposed to pull that off?" I said, "Just play it straight. You know, you're a doctor."
I'm going to have to go with a big no.
And I kind of like the fact that he's supposed to have like a lighthearted sex advice show, and he's playing some different sound effects in the background, trying to make it funny. So when somebody calls in with a serious question that's very uncomfortable, and the caller keeps making it even more uncomfortable, he kind of panics and hits all the wrong buttons. And Jen just delivers a great scene where her jaw drops open, and she says, "Oh my God, how are we going to get out of this?"
Do it for today's show. Coming up next is Alana, who will keep all of you loving.
And of course, this scene, we wanted to unveil, you know, the seasons as they progress during the soap opera to give people more of a feeling of how soon will it be before they graduate. So this one takes place at Halloween. There's a Christmas episode. There's one that takes
place
with
a little bit of a New Year's.
Right. So, I mean, I thought a seasonal kind of stuff was very important. And for whatever reason, Grant's lack of focus happened in this scene very bad. We had to feed him every single line for whatever reason. I think he just got flustered that he just wasn't doing it. And
Titanic, or at least rotating shifts.
Well, after that,
we literally had to feed him almost every single line. That's why there's so much editing during this particular conversation.
Pancake syrup.
And for some people, this scene sort of throws like a kind of a curve, because some people interpret this as maybe a connection between him and her, but yet she had that conversation with her and Brett, and you don't really know like which person she's going to end up with just yet, or if she's going to end up with anybody. It's kind of neat.
Yeah, for some reason, Mary Muley, who plays Cindy, thought that there was a lot of heat between Cleve and Jen in this scene. And I didn't feel that at all. I just thought that some information had to be revealed, and she said, "Oh, well, you can tell in Bree's eyes or Jen's eyes that she's really wanting Grant here, or Cleve." And I was like, "No, I don't get that at all." Do you?
No, I just think it was. I think some people interpret that because it's just like it's a playful conversation, but like she's interested and concerned in him, and a lot of times people think that might be something else, or have the potential, excuse me, to be something else. So,
well, the interesting about this scene too is,
and this idea for a movie is absolutely horrible, and I think that's what's so funny about this.
Yeah.
Instead of a post truck, it's a garbage truck.
Yeah.
And inside the garbage truck, there's all this old nuclear waste.
And yeah. And he has this great idea for a complete flop.
And and get this, whenever he's doing that, his tagline is, "It's time to take out the trash." You get
it's
it?
It's horrible.
I'm taking out the trash.
Well, Cleve is supposed to be a filmmaker,
yeah.
And you know, he has all these wacky ideas, and I kind of like the fact that he's a filmmaker, but he's a horrible filmmaker.
Yeah.
He has all these horrible ideas.
Brett, huh? I thought there was a chemistry between you two.
No, what chemistry?
Come on, Jen. We've all seen the way you two look at each other.
Spielberg.
See, I just don't understand where Mary, or where Cindy got the feeling that there was any heat between these two. They're talking about some other relationship.
But she's denying it, too, that they have a chemistry. So a lot of times people do that if they're around somebody they like. I don't know. It's not the impression I got from this scene, but she's saying her and some other people got that impression, so.
It's funny, in the behind-the-scenes retrospective we did for this, Grant was complaining because he literally did fudge almost every single line in order. And he was saying, "Look at all this dialogue I have, then look at hers, one line. Then I have about five paragraphs," and she says, "What?" And then I have five more paragraphs, she says, "That's neat." You know, she says, "No wonder I'm screwing up." So he kind of had a valid point, you know, we all took it in stride. It was a little stressful that day because we just wanted to get it done, but looking back, it's kind of funny.
Best new music anywhere, WCAL.
So regarding the relationship between Cindy and Cleve, he just revealed for the first time that Cindy lied, that he didn't rape her. Now you have a conflict between the two, one word against the other. I thought that was kind of
And you sort of have, and Jen's in the middle of both of them. She sort of is like the person who, you know, hears all of this. Mm-hmm. She's a new person, and yet she gets the most information about everyone. It's
Yeah, exactly. And it comes out to a third party. And I think that now she's drawn into it and didn't even want to be, you know?
I'm beginning to hate this frickin' song.
Now, this particular line here that Dante says when he said,
Cindy's here.
I don't know if he said it or not. I might have missed it.
Or he says, I'm beginning to hate this song?
No.
Some problems with one of our classes.
Really?
About cat food.
Oh, yeah, he already said it.
Oh, did he really?
Yeah. Smells like cat food in here. We were supposed to have a cat, but we didn't.
There it is.
There it is, okay. I thought he already said it.
Smells like cat food in here.
Now, originally that line was supposed to be because Cindy, who's played by Mary Muley, was supposed to own a cat in the house. And we left it in the script because it just never really popped out because I thought it was kind of funny anyway. It smells like cat food in here, you know? And not having a cat, I thought that was doubly funny, so we left it in.
Frankenstein and me, Creepy Mark.
Stop it.
Well, the both of you here are supposed to have a couple drinks in you. You're not really supposed to be intoxicated, but it's the first time that you as Laura and the audience learns that Mark has dreams just like anybody else, but you kind of feel sorry for him because he feels sorry for himself. He just got embarrassed at the bar, shot down by a girl because of his disability, in front of his friend, who also happens to be a woman. You know, it's a lot of major complications there. And I like the fact he knows his way around the room. You know?
Yeah, he always does that little bed flippy thing, which I thought was cute.
Mm-hmm.
That's my code again.
Now, one thing that we did was that one of the production technicians had, and I see the chess set there on the table.
Yeah.
They thought that was kind of ironic that it was in Mark's room. Now you're probably wondering how, right? And originally it was done as a gag for Dante, but we thought it kind of added a touch of class because what blind man plays chess?
Right.
And if you look around, there's a lot of racing trophies and you slowly learn how he got blind, how he lost his sight. And this, of course, draws you in.
You never even asked me how it happened before.
I just never thought you would want to talk about it before.
But you were curious, right?
Yeah, I was.
This scene was kind of hard because it was all him. It was all his dialogue, his story, his emotion, and I kind of had to, like, do a lot of, you know, looking like you're interested, but, like, really, really interested, and, like, you know, you really feel sorry for him, but not, like, you know, sorry for him. It's more like Laura wants to do something, but she can't, so it was just a lot of, like, silent, like, emotions that you just had to act while you were acting like you were paying attention to him, and it was easy because I didn't have a whole lot of lines, but at the same time, like, that sort of thing is difficult because sometimes I feel like I'm making a goofy face or, you know.
I always thought that Laura was the strongest character out of all of the main stars, and she's out of her element here because normally she can do anything she wants. She's that dependable or that confident, you know what I mean? And when she finds out this secret of Dante's and she can't do anything about it, it's for the first time really she starts to feel a little powerless because Laura is always the one who's in control, you know. And when Dante tells her, like, a dream that he'll never be able to achieve, that he wants to race cars again, which is how he lost his sight in the first place, it's really sad because it's like, you know, wanting to go to the moon. What are your chances of going to the moon, you know? Zero. You know, and it's nice that I think that you pulled off this particular scene well because of the reactions you give to the story. Or you look rather sleepy.
It was probably like 2 in the morning, so I probably was.
What were we saying, Mark?
Time for old Mark to go to bed.
Dante always pulled that stare off well. You know what I mean? It was always funny because every time we get ready to start a take with him, he'd close his eyes real tight and then open them and he said, "I'm ready." And we used to call it Boy in the Bubble. Because he looks so pathetic at times. Other times he can be so funny. And this is for the first time you realize you're starting to get drawn into something that Laura has never experienced before. Well, for a long time, you're starting to care about somebody.
Sometimes dreams are all we have. You know, Mark, just because you're blind, it doesn't mean that you're dead.
I liked this, because this was, like, something unexpected, and Laura was like, whoa.
Yeah.
Because she's not used to a guy just kind of, you know, just holding her hand and being like, oh, thank you, and then leave. Like, Laura's kind of, she doesn't date guys like that. She doesn't date nice guys. She doesn't have relationships that are based on anything beyond, like, you know, physical things, so right. It was kind of cool that she, like, did a little, you know, she wanted to pull away, but she didn't because she realizes that he's a friend.
And I love how you pulled that scene off, too, because as it turns out, you know, you were startled, but then at the end you're like, mission accomplished, and then you said goodnight, Mark, and you smiled, and you thought you made everything okay. And when you walked out, you kind of had that unsure of yourself when you walked out, and then he's picking up his trophy and realizing everything you said is kind of like a crock because he's really missing what he had. And you came back, and this is when you start to fall for him. I think this is probably the first time you really start to fall for him. What do you think?
Oh, yeah.
Some of those Frankenstein shoes.
Hey, I like those shoes.
You're already tall, and you're wearing shoes that make you even taller.
I just like those shoes.
You really feel sorry for Mark here. I did. He has all those posters up in his room, and he reveals, of course, even though that he can't see them, he still knows that they're there and they're important. Now this is an important scene too, because you realize that not as everything is quite as happy as you think it is with Jen and her fiancé, Tom. She's away at college, he's miles and miles and miles away, hours away, and they're trying to make a long-distance relationship work, and it's really impossible. You know, it's very difficult to make a long-distance relationship work, and she's trying to experience that. Here she finds out that someone else answered the phone. There was a woman, and she's a little startled at that.
Tom there?
He's busy right now. May I take a message?
She handles it very well, though. I can't say that in her same situation in real life, I would have handled it that good. She's like, no message, bye. I'd have been like, and who are you?
And you start to realize that things aren't really that good with those two, and you know, I think for the progression of the entire soap opera, the way that we set up the relationships in between, you want to see certain people together. You know, it's the way it is in all soap operas, and it just ain't happening, you know? And you really know that her and Brett are made for each other. You really know that Laura and Mark are made for each other. And there are hints of Cleve and Cindy being for each other. And then you have the star-lost, love-lost lovers between Kim and Jack, who are totally in love but eternally apart, you know? And I think there was a little something for everybody in this.
I have no idea, but we didn't do anything.
And now the truth comes out to him.
Anything.
Nothing. Hell no.
Regarding Cleve about that night that he was with Cindy.
Cindy and I are friends, nothing more.
So then, what was the big fight between you and Jack about?
I just figured Jack was mad because Cindy kissed me.
That scene, of course, was shot in front of our university campus, Old Main, underneath the clock towers. And then we have a transition from Halloween to Christmas, and I think this transition worked out pretty decent.
Yeah. It's just, this was so hard this year, because Christmas we'd have snow, like, one week, and the next week it'd look like summer again, like, it was so green, and it was just real hard to like get any kind of like outdoor like continuity with
it.
It was just
difficult.
It was just a really weird winter.
You know, after I started editing this whole thing together, Mary here, who plays Cindy, brought up a point. All I do is write in books, answer phones, and answer doors. And that's not the way that her character was supposed to turn out, but I started to think, she's right. So we expanded her character after she told me.
And who's that? That's Erik. Again. That is so you.
That's
I was there. That's you.
Oh, I guess you were there. Well, that wasn't really an intentional cameo. We just needed a body to walk by. I think you look great there when you do that. I can't believe you.
In the first couple episodes, you'll notice I wear my glasses on my head. That's because they're my sister's, and she's, like, legally blind, practically. And when I put them on, like, one of my eyes go crossed, so I always have to wear them on my head. Because I thought that's a neat little, like, intelligent thing about Laura, like, wearing glasses. But I could never do it until I, like, got a pair that were fake. So for the first couple episodes, I had to borrow hers, and I always wore them on my head.
I like that scene there, too, with Jack.
always urinating himself on stage.
No one's going to understand it unless you watch the whole series, but we'll leave that for the people who want to see, be surprised. And Jen's window shopping downtown, looking for gifts here and there, because it's Christmas time, of course. And I like this.
This is adorable.
He's so proud of the fact that he decorated the tree and it looks really horrible. And it's, you know, like I said, and I told Grant when we did our commentary too, with Dante, I wanted a character that we could make fun of. I wanted him to be like anybody else, you know? Anybody else. Just because he has a disability doesn't make that we should always feel sorry for him. I mean, he's supposed to be funny.
Well, it could be a very good opportunity for you. Rehearsal!
So now the plot thickens for Jack. Of course, Kim got the offer from Clayton Booth to go to New York and pursue his what was supposed to be Jack's career. And he took offense to that, and they left under bad words to each other. And now he's made the same offer.
Yes, I know what you think, but you know, you could be wrong about it.
Bill Bennett, who plays Dr. Etling, is a dream to work with. He's had so much theater experience, you could hand him an entire script and he'd look at it and have it memorized and ready to go.
And when he refused, she got very, very aggressive, so... Well, he gave her a part.
He's a great English professor. I've had him for class.
Have you actually had him?
I've had him three times for class. He was the very first professor I had at college, so...
Really?
Yeah. Oh, me and Bill, we go way back.
He was one of the very first professors I had when I went to college, too. I mean, he's been here forever. He used to run the university newspaper on the campus in real life.
There's a plane ticket in here.
Yes, Clayton thinks you're perfect.
Now, of course, this scene sets up Jack's decision. Should he screw his best friend and potential love interest? Should he stab her in the back and jump at the chance to go to New York, despite bad things that have happened to her up there? Or should he not? So I think this is kind of an important scene because he was just offered the golden monkey, you know what I mean? And he's thinking, well, should I or shouldn't I?
It's the opportunity of a lifetime, Jack. The opportunity of a lifetime.
What would you do? See ya! I'm off to my chase my dreams!
Oh.
I like this transition here from one wide-angle shot to another wide-angle shot, too. I think that worked out well, especially when you go from one classroom to another. Maybe it could have been happening at the same time. And, of course, we start to reveal some of the villains on the show, and, of course, Professor Filosi here, played craftily by Michael Slavin.
Oh, he is so good at this. He's, like, the ultimate slime ball in this. He does such a good job.
Uh-huh.
And he's the total opposite in real life. Like, he's the nicest guy in the world, so you know he does a good job. He is. He's the total opposite. Like, I've talked to him before. I auditioned for a play in the theater department one time. He's just a really nice guy.
He does play a really good slime. He's craftily trying to play on that young college mind, I guess, or the impressionable mind, and says, oh, we're just going to go out and get something to eat. You know, and he has all kinds of ulterior motives.
It's just a drink, Cindy.
And in true women's fashion, Cindy listens to her intuition and is like, I got to get out of here.
I was shopping with her.
Oh, well, maybe some other time.
I think Professor Filosi, more than trying to get on Cindy, enjoys the game more.
Yeah.
He's more of the spider. And I really like the transition, I mentioned it earlier, into that great big giant shot of the classroom, because that's a web. And did you notice at the center were those two? And I always looked at these two as the spider and the fly, and he's just, I think he enjoys the pursuit. If Cindy ever played up to him and said, okay, let's get it on, Professor Filosi, I don't think that he would really enjoy it as much, because there would be no game, you know? And that was a nice little added touch on Michael's part. He wanted to have that little, And of course, since the show is based on cliffhangers, this is the cliffhanger for this, for the third episode.
Which I caught so much crap for all over campus. Everybody I knew was like, what's that? What's that from? And, you know, why'd you do that? And, oh.
Why? I don't understand.
Oh, you know what? I was thinking of, the cliffhanger from the second one. I was in the cliffhanger for the second one, and I always get all these questions. I get questions about all the cliffhangers, like this one, too. They're like, is she home? Where is she at? And everybody's always wants to know about the cliffhangers, and you have to explain to them. That's why they're cliffhangers, because you're not supposed to know.
I like the fact that in the next episode, we experiment with your character a little bit, too.
Oh, no, it's the Big Apple.
And, of course, the cliffhanger was Kim was gone to New York, and now she's back. And or is she? She's calling. And
yeah. That was the big thing. People thought she was back when they were talking to me. Like, where's she at? She come home. She didn't tell anybody. And I was like, I can't tell you.
You know, we like to do a little bit of teasing the audience here with what the next episode is going to be. And we had fun with that. And that was it for the third episode. It's like
good times.
We just started.
I know.
An hour's gone by fast, huh?
Mm-hmm.
So, we hope that we thank you for inviting us into your living rooms or wherever you're watching this to talk about the third episode. And thank you for helping us on this commentary for the third one. Appreciate it,
thank
Jess.
You for directing and everything. And we just hope everybody keeps watching.
We had a good time with it. We had a really good response. I thought the response was bigger than it's much bigger than I expected.
Yeah, definitely.
It went beyond the campus because the show was cable casted out into different cable systems everywhere, and we've had a lot of recognition from various, I guess you could call them fans, who want to know what's going to happen each and every week, and it's been a lot of fun. I'm glad that everybody's getting the recognition. And I don't think I've ever worked with such a talented cast as I have with you guys. It was just, you guys have managed to pull off some really great stuff. And I've always been amazed by that.
It was a lot of fun.
Okay, so until next time for the next commentary, with whom I have no idea, maybe we'll have you again.
That'd be lovely.
We will see you then. Take care. And keep watching in Neon, right?
Yep.
We'll see you next time. I'll take you there.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
what's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.
What's the look?
The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible instant, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way. The look, my good woman, is when someone you're interested in is walking out, you know, like they're leaving, and at the last possible moment, they turn around and look at you one more time, and then they're on their merry way.